Google employees' anti-diversity manifesto goes internally viral. That's a story from Motherboard that just went up today, talking about a document that was released internally yesterday on Friday. The title of the document itself was Google's Ideological Echo Chamber, and within it, the author spoke about a few different things. For one, it called out the heavily leftist-leaning ideology and the corporate mentality that permeate Google as a culture, saying that if you have a conservative viewpoint, it's shunned. You're not allowed to speak up or share it or interact or even bring it forward. It also talked about the idea of merit-based hiring, saying that this search to fill a quota is actually hurting productivity because you're not hiring the right people for the job. At Google, I feel like there's a lot of pushback from white dudes who genuinely feel like diversity is lowering the bar. A former engineering employee who wished to remain anonymous because they had signed a non-disclosure agreement told Motherboard. While the article goes on to say the vast majority of Google employees did not support the document, apparently some did. And according to Dogan, who is part of the Go Programming Language Initiative, their response to this was to state, "The author is now in contact with me explaining why he received supportive responses. If HR does nothing in this case, I will consider leaving the company for real for the first time in 5 years." And sure enough, if you were to go look at their Twitter account, that is what they said, that they will leave the company due to this being written if HR does not directly address it, and essentially mocking the individual for bringing up these points, which in essence reaffirms what they're saying, that there is a corporate culture in Google right now that if you have a conservative viewpoint, or if that viewpoint differs in any way from the accepted majority, that you need to be ousted and taken care of, because different thinking, different viewpoints, and different arguments are not presentable. And she goes further than just demanding that essentially he be fired. She begins to outright mock him. "Dear white men that think they are marginalized, my single eyelash is more marginalized in tech than all of you." Now, I want you to take a moment to imagine that this manifesto, this memo, had been written by anybody else. If a black woman had written this memo, if a gay man had written this memo, if a Muslim man had written this memo and said that they felt that they were somehow discriminated against, or that the practices of the company were negative when applied towards them, if anybody would dare to come out publicly and say what this particular employee is saying. But because the person that wrote it is a white male, it's permissible to do, which seems to reinforce his entire point in the beginning, that there is a corporate culture which is hostile towards certain viewpoints. Now, there are a few interesting facts surrounding the release of this particular article and the memo that preceded it. The memo that was sent out on the 4th. It was sent out on Friday. That would be 3 days after what happened to Jordan Peterson. Now, in my previous video, I covered that scenario. Jordan Peterson was completely deplatformed. He had access to all of his Google accounts completely revoked. Not just his YouTube channel, but his Gmail as well. There was no notification. There was no warning. It was simply done. He couldn't access it because it no longer existed. Now, due to Jordan Peterson's size and the influence that he wields, because he's pretty popular, he has a lot of people that follow him, he was able to get them to reverse this decision, even though they initially denied his appeal, again, citing no reasoning behind that. Now, I would say it's very interesting that after this happens to Jordan Peterson, within a matter of a few days, people working internally at Google release a memo to everybody at the company saying, "We've got some issues internally, that there exists a corporate culture that is hostile towards conservative viewpoints and different ways of thinking." Because Jordan Peterson holds some of the same ideals that were brought up in this memo, talking about meritocracy, talking about who deserves to work and who doesn't deserve to work, talking about differences in men and women, talking about the dangers of purely doing diversity hires. There's some similar things in there. Now, even more coincidentally, on the same day that Jordan Peterson's account was shut down and his access to his accounts were completely revoked, the ADL, the Anti-Defamation League, tweeted this out, saying how they were proud to be part of the new YouTube Flagger program, which is just an outgrowth of YouTube Heroes, which in essence is just a snitching program for people with no sense of humor. Because the individuals who are going to dedicate the most time to taking down videos they dislike are usually going to be the people with the worst sense of humor, and therefore the most easily offended. And so here's the ADL, along with a lot of other heavily leftist organizations, taking part directly with Google and YouTube to decide what is allowable and what isn't. And this goes hand in hand with the new limited state proposal that YouTube is pushing forward. And in a limited state, what YouTube means by that is when they find a video that doesn't violate their terms of service, which means that there is nothing about it which should prevent it from being viewable and accessible on the website, they instead will get rid of it through a new mechanism. And that mechanism is the limited state. By putting it into a limited state, they remove the ability to like it, they remove the ability to comment on it, they remove the ability to share it or to put it into a playlist. It exists in a purgatory, a wrongthink purgatory, for videos that offend certain individuals and certain groups, particularly those on the YouTube Flagger program, and make them go away. Now, when I talked about this earlier in the week, particularly about what happened to Jordan Peterson and talking about the limited state aspect of what Google was going to be introducing, I didn't get a chance to really go into some new things that are coming down the pipeline. And I didn't get to explain why personally, at least for me, I see a very dark day coming ahead. So I'd like to try to put that argument to you in a more cohesive and understandable way. And to do that, we're going to look at a few things. The first of which is the Alexa website ratings. We're going to take a look at the most popular websites, the most viewed websites, the most traffic websites on the internet as they are today. And I want you to see if you notice a pattern, because this is going to play into a very important part at the end of the video. So the very first site we're greeted with is Google.com, number one, and its search engine. Now, in the articles talking about the limited state and what was going to be happening on YouTube, it also talked about an approach Google was going to use for search results, where if you looked up a controversial subject, it would send you to a video that tried to belay your fears. They would try to calm you down and give you the correct interpretation of what you were looking for, rather than the most searched or most interesting information related to that topic. Now, I can give you an example of this. Google manipulates search results to conceal criticisms of Islam and jihad. Now, in this particular article, they cite a Turkish website talking about how they had a victory, over search results, and how it's more pleasant for them now. And that Turkish website says, U.S. Muslim groups welcome changes to Google results. Now, this all began about a month ago, when an imam in the United States had issues with the results he was seeing. Huffington Post wrote an article about it. Google search is doing irreparable harm to Muslims. And now, if you were to go onto a private browsing window, and you were to search up a term like Sharia law or jihad, you're going to find some interesting results. What you're going to find 9 times out of 10, almost 10 times out of 10 now, aren't dealing with any brutal realities of it, but cookie cutter, soft and simple, milquetoast explanations. But the takeaway from it is, the search results have been altered, and that's something Google is actively working towards. That's something they want to engage in. Next on the list is YouTube.com. Well, we've already talked a little bit about what YouTube is going to do. We know they're going to introduce a limited state where they put accounts into a purgatory where you can never find them again, as well as ramping up the YouTube Hero and YouTube Flagger communities to empower them to take down more and more content they deem to be offensive, but not a violation of terms of service. However, I'd like to argue a phenomena I brought up back in a video called A Tale of Two Accounts. I believe that there's an attempt to diminish and isolate and to disenfranchise people to the point where they stop making content. And I believe that is done through a manipulation of metrics, specifically targeted towards comments. Now, if you were to look at the information I'm about to show you, I've done this a multitude of different ways. I've used Social Blade to track it. I've used archive.s to take screen caps of the same page over and over and over for days at a time to confirm that this is really happening. And what you'll notice are thousands upon thousands upon thousands of comments mysteriously disappearing. And they're not disappearing because they're being held as spam. We're not talking about 100 or even 1,000 comments. I myself have lost upwards of 15,000 to 20,000 comments on a variety of videos going back all the way to the beginning of my channel. If you look at We Was Kings, I'm missing upwards of 3,000 to 4,000 comments. If you look at Tumblrisms, I'm missing 5,000 comments. If you look at Double O Dipshit, not only did I lose comments, I lost 400 comments in the span of 5,000 views on the exact same day. People were actually asking me what was happening because all the information they were posting was almost instantly disappearing. And you can see from the screen caps, the earlier count is at nearly 1,200 comments and the bottom count is well below that. And this happens continually. Also within the video of A Tale of Two Accounts, if you were to go and take a look, you'll see that when you're logged in on an account, you see a total of comments, likes, and views, but when you're logged in as a creator, the number is wildly different. They show you two completely different numbers. And this diminishment, this disappearance of these ratings, of these metrics, happens within moments. It's not that this is bled off little by little over the span of weeks and months. It's one day you'll have 10,000 comments, and then a minute later, 7,000. With no explanation, with no mechanism explaining it. And just to make it clear, I have no banned words, I have no muted words, I have no banned users, I don't delete comments. So what's disappearing is not through me. This isn't something I'm doing. I haven't taken the time to go and delete 20,000 fucking comments. This is something that YouTube is doing, and YouTube has been doing for a while. And I would highly suggest, if you have a channel with a lot of videos on it, to just go and compare your YouTube statistics to something like Social Blade. Or the next time you put a video out, archive the page on archive.is, and then go back a few days later and archive it again. And do that for a week. You might be surprised to find how many things start disappearing on you that you might not otherwise have noticed. This seems to be the approach that YouTube is going to take. Isolate and contain. Diminish the results and disenfranchise the user. Make it so they get no feedback. Make it so their message doesn't spread. Make it so they can't get a following. In essence, unperson them as opposed to deplatform them. After YouTube, we have Facebook.com, one of the more frequently trafficked social media websites. Now, anybody that's used Facebook for any extended amount of time can tell you what happens when you make a joke or post an image that Facebook doesn't like. They'll either remove the post entirely or outright kick you off the website. They will shut down your page. And it's no secret that people like Mark Zuckerberg is talking to people like Angela Merkel and talking to different people within the structure of the EU about combating hate speech. He's openly admitted this. He's talked about this in his manifesto. He's talked about this publicly, about taking down the kind of content that he deems to be toxic and removing it from the platform. And that's not even touching on the allegations of the newsfeed manipulation that went on for the past year and a half in regards to lowering the results of conservative outlets as opposed to liberal outlets when people were given a news feed. Now, the fourth main site, surprisingly, is Baidu.com, a Chinese website, which plays into that title because by the end of this, you're really going to want to learn Chinese if you want to shitpost in the next 5 years because that may be your refuge. Sure, the Chinese are totalitarian when it comes to their internet, but I don't think they really care if you call Mark Zuckerberg a fucking retard. Number five on the list, Wikipedia.org. Well, Wikipedia is its own entire clusterfuck. For anybody that remembers what happened during Gamergate and the article specifically on Wikipedia about it, you know all the behind-the-scenes bullshit that happened. All the drama on the discussion pages, the bias that was put into the article, using sources that were involved in the problem to quote themselves to explain there was no problem. So Wikipedia, the bastion for lazy people when it comes to obtaining knowledge, is already seeing a situation where certain viewpoints are being pushed forward. We're no longer in the time period where you could create a Wikipedia editor account and go in and do what you want. Now you have to be chosen. You have to be given a special nod to be allowed to do things like that. Otherwise, your work is instantly reverted. You need to be invited on to do this. And then at number nine, we have Reddit.com. Reddit.com, a place that shadow bans users they disagree with. Reddit.com, where the owners and operators and admins will secretly edit your posts to make them say other things because they think it's funny. Outright banning certain subreddits from being put on the front page, or promoting stories that wouldn't really be popular, but are popular because they're thought of as the right way of doing things. And then all the way down there at number 13 is Twitter.com. Now, Twitter.com has its own issues going on. Jack is engaging in throttling, a way of targeting users to diminish their reach and cut them off from a support base. namely the people that follow them. And that's not merely speculation on my part because I did a video on it. 4 days after I did that video, Twitter essentially came out and admitted that yes, that actually is something they do. They do engage in that. And so you're able to see the top sites which really dominate internet usage are social media and video platform oriented. They're sites where people go to communicate with other people. And the metrics and the numbers and the studies that have been done play out on this. One interesting study that was done by the National Bureau of Economic Research talked about the type of people and the amount of time they spend online. And to give you the short and quick of it, researchers also found that households with annual incomes of $25,000 to $35,000 spent an average of 92 minutes more time online than households making $100,000 or more, the average amount being 2 hours per household in the U.S. Essentially, what that means is the lower middle class to low class spends upwards of an hour and a half more online than the middle class and upper class. And where are they spending that time? Again, if you were to look at some of the numbers from studies that have come out over the last couple of years, you can see that social media sites really dominate this. You've got Facebook, which is doing monumentally well, with Twitter kind of staggering behind it. Hell, even MySpace is still listed there because I guess some indie band hasn't found a better way to promote their shitty record yet. But nonetheless, they're listed. A more detailed breakdown gives you even per minute, saying the average user will spend 40 minutes per day on YouTube, 35 minutes per day on Facebook, followed by Snapchat and Instagram, and Twitter dead last at 1 minute. Now you might be wondering, why does Twitter have such a dramatic drop-off for the amount of use time per day per user? Well, you could ask Jack Dorsey about that. It might have to do with the fact that he has gone so far overboard in banning actual users that his website is now almost dominated by bot accounts. When you have 300 plus million users, and upwards of 15% of them are bot accounts, you're looking at a website which has nearly 45 million accounts which aren't human beings, and they don't get banned. They continue being their body little selves and doing the shit that they always do. So when you get rid of all the humorous people, and you get rid of all the right-wing politics, and you get rid of all the conservatives, and you get rid of all the porn, you're left with really left-leaning individuals and a lot of bots. And that's not mere speculation on my part when it comes to a left-leaning bias that's developing on Twitter right now. You can see this play itself out with a very simple example. Go look at Donald Trump's Twitter account and compare what it used to look like before the election to what it looks like after the election. Before the election, the responses to his tweets would be varied. He would get people yelling at him, but he would also get a lot of support. And that would fluctuate between who was that first response and who wasn't. But after the election, and after this crackdown that we've seen taking place on Twitter, almost 9 times out of 10, if not 10 times out of 10, the responses you will almost always see will be blue checkmark, leftist-leaning individuals who have something bad to say about Donald Trump. You can see the shift that has taken place in that span of 6 months from a more diverse user base to a much more narrow and defined user base. So what does this all mean? When you take all of this information and you put it together and you kind of try to look at it as a big picture, well, what we see is this. You have a group of people, lower income, lower middle class, who more than likely are going to be millennials, who spend the most amount of time online. And the time they spend online is dedicated to a few key platforms, namely social media. And that is what they focus on. Now, if you wanted to sway an entire demographic of disenfranchised, lower middle class millennials, and you wanted to make sure the message you gave them was concrete, without any interference, what would be the best way of going about that? Well, you would want to control the main sites that they spend the majority of that 3 hours a day on, which would be Google, Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter. And what we're seeing right now is that exactly happening. You're seeing Google get rid of the content they don't like, which is usually right-leaning. You're seeing Facebook get rid of content they don't like, which is usually right-leaning. You're seeing Twitter get rid of content they don't like, which again is usually right-leaning. All in an effort to create, as the internal memo that went out at Google said, a ideological echo chamber where only one opinion is accepted and all other voices are driven out or drown out. Now, the person who wrote that memo is probably going to be fired. They'll be a martyr and nobody will know their name because they dared to say something against corporate culture at Google. I don't think that it's going to end well for them, but I am impressed that they took the time to say it because I think maybe even employees at Google see where this is going and probably don't like the direction it's headed. We like to imagine that we have the ability to strike back, to fight back against these sorts of things. But you have to understand, it's one thing to notice that it's happening, and it's another thing to be able to inform people that it's happening. And I truly believe that the election of Donald Trump has played a major role in this. I think that social media saw the websites and the mechanisms that he used to get elected, and they told themselves internally, or maybe together, we will never ever allow this to happen again. So as a more totalitarian, Orwellian dystopian future begins to creep in on us on the internet, the question I leave you with is, how are you going to inform people what they're missing? You're not going to be able to email them. Google won't let you. They won't let you have a Gmail account. They'll take it away. Or they'll find some way of auto-spamming and blocking out what you have to send. They're not going to let you put a YouTube video up. And if you do put one up, it'll be in a limited state. It'll be in purgatory. Nobody will watch it. You won't be able to share it on Facebook because Zuckerberg won't allow it. It's hate speech. And Merkel told them so. Jack Dorsey shadow banned you, so your tweets aren't going to go anywhere. So what mechanism, what way of fighting back does the internet have in this dystopic future? How do we get the message out? What website is going to allow us to accomplish that? It's all well and good to share it amongst ourselves, to be the canary in the coal mine, but it does us no good if we can't convince the other people who aren't canaries that shit's about to happen, because they're all going to get buried under rubble. Be assured that these policy changes and approaches which are going to be implemented on the internet are going to make it next to impossible for us to communicate our viewpoints going forward. I believe that it's politically motivated. I believe that there is a heavily leftist-leaning bias at these companies, and I think they know what they're doing, and I think they don't care that they're doing it. They don't uphold free speech. They don't care about free speech. They want their speech. You can make the argument all day that they are a private corporation and they have the right to run their website any way they want to. That's not the argument I'm making with you here. What I'm saying is, this is what is going to happen. And for those people that aren't willing to be complacent and lay down and see the danger that's coming around the bend, how are we going to deal with it? Because I think it is time to really talk about what the fucking plan is. Because at this point, we definitely need one.